Okay, so let me start then. My name is Nikita Kirsanov. I'm a PhD student and I work at Aalto University and Moscow Institute of Physics and Technology under the supervision of Professor Pertti Hakkinen and Professor Gardzeli Savik. And today I wanted to talk about the non-local thermoelectric effect in a graphene cooper pair splitter, an experiment, the first evidence of the non-local thermoelectricity appearing due to the cooper pair splitting and elastic tunneling. So first, the brief plan of my today's talk. I'm going to start with a small theoretical introduction. Then we're going to look into the experimental setup which we used. And finally, I'm going to discuss the experimental results and the results of our theoretical modeling. So recently, it has been shown that the Seebeck effect can originate from cooper pair splitting and elastic tunneling. So cooper pair Seebeck effect is when a temperature difference generates electric current, and so this kind of effect can actually appear in a hybrid N-S-N systems where N stands for the normal conductor, S stands for the superconductor. So assume that we have this kind of a device, N-S-N device, and we have quantum dots on the N-S borders. In this type of device, there can appear this cooper pair splitting effect, which lays in the following process. So suppose that you have a cooper pair inside the superconductor and it splits into two electrons, and those electrons are injected into the opposite quantum dots. Alternatively, one can see this process of cooper pair splitting as the following. You have a particle, electron coming from the left side, then it is transmitted through this dot S dot structure as a whole into the opposite side. So let's just look at the formulas and see how the structure of the non-local thermoelectricity. And this non-local thermoelectricity is very interesting because first, it's interesting fundamentally because it's an unknown mechanism for the thermoelectricity to appear, and secondly, it is interesting from the practical point of view because this non-local thermoelectricity allows to generate entangled electrons from the temperature difference. So assume that we have we'll consider the subgap region where the energy of the particles is smaller than the superconducting gap. Then the process of elastic tunneling and the cooper pair splitting have the following probabilities. So here in this formulas, tau L is the transmission probability of the left quantum dot, tau R is the transmission probability of the right quantum dot, and tau S is the transmission probability of the superconductor. So the transmission probability of the dot in a simple resonance tunneling model is just a sum of Lorentzians, and the position of those Lorentzians can be changed by the gate voltage on the dot. Tau S, the transmission probability through the superconductor, can be assumed to be constant in the case where the distance between the dots is smaller than the coherent length. And this transmission probability through the superconductor is basically the probability that a particle coming from the left is transmitted into the right quantum dot instead of flying away into the bulk of the superconductor. So as for the thermoelectricity, there are two main contributions to the thermoelectricity in this kind of device. So let's look, let's suppose that we're like, if we're interested in the current on the left, then the current on the left is a sum of the local contribution and the non-local contribution. The local contributions appear due to the temperature difference between the normal part and the superconductor. And the non-local contribution appears from the temperature difference between two opposite normal parts. And it appears due to the Cooper pair splitting and lasting Katanen effects. So here are the formulas for the non-local current on the left and on the right, expressed in terms of the contributions which can be attributed to elastic Katanen and Cooper pair splitting. And for those, we have Landauer's like expressions in the Landauer's formula for in the Landauer's form, and we can also derive Mott-like equations and find that the non-local currents depend in this way, have this kind of behavior depending on the left and right conductor, like the conductance of the left and right dots. So moving on to our experimental setup. So we wanted to see this kind of non-local thermoelectricity experimentally. And to observe it, we've made a graphene-based Cooper pair splitting device. So here, green is graphene, blue is aluminum, and gray is the substrate. So in the middle, we have an aluminum superconductor, which overlaps two graphene quantum dots. And those graphene quantum dots can be seen in this picture. So the gate voltage on the quantum dots is regulated by these two additional electrodes. So they can be actually changed independently of each other. Moving on to this Josephson junctions. This is the S graphene superconductor graphene superconductor junction. And the same junction we have on the right. These are the Josephson junction thermometers. So if we the supercurrent through this kind of junctions depends on the temperature exponentially. So we can measure the supercurrent and thus measure the temperature indirectly. So we use these two junctions for measuring temperature on the left and on the right. And finally, we have a heater. The heater is two electrodes connected via a graphene nanoribbon. And the heater is electrically isolated from the rest of the scheme, so it does not influence the electrical current through the scheme in any way other than like inducing the thermal current through through the transmission of the heat via the substrate. And the heater is driven at frequency 2.1 hertz. So this means that the thermoelectric current has a frequency of 4.2 hertz because it's the double frequency. And we measure this thermoelectric currents using the standard locking technique. So we can measure the total thermoelectric current on the left and on the right, but we're interested only in the non-local contribution. So how do we infer the non-local contribution from the total current? So suppose we have a total current through the left dot, and we want to infer the non-local contribution to this total current. To this, we notice that the local current always depends only on one of the gate voltages, whereas the non-local current depends on both gate voltages. So we can actually infer the non-local contribution by subtracting from the current on the left its averaged value over the gate voltage on the right. And this would give us the non-local contribution. So here are the formulas for the non-local contribution on the left and non-local contribution on the right. So moving on to some of the results of our experiment. In the left upper corner, you can see the measured total currents on the left and on the right as functions of the gate voltages of the left and right dots. And you can see that, for example, the current on the right does not really depend on the gate voltage on the left. And this is because the non-local contribution is very small. And this is almost like, it almost equals to the local thermoelectric current, which depends only on one of the gate voltages. So now here we can see the plots for the experimental plots for the conductance of the right dot as function of the gate voltage on the right. And this is the plot for the conductance of the left dot as function of the gate voltage on the left. So finally, in the middle here, we have the non-local thermoelectric current on the left. And this plot corresponds to this and this selected regions. So this is, these two plots are, I mean, this plot is corresponds to, I mean, this is plotted in the vicinity of this conductance peaks. Same can be said about this one. So how do we, finally we have this, our theoretical modeling results, and how do we model the non-local thermoelectricity? We use the formulas I showed you in the beginning, and we fit the conductance peaks. And once we fit the conductance, we have fit the conductance peaks, we use the fitting parameters and put it in our formula and obtain the non-local current. Sometimes the peaks, this conductance peaks have this kind of small splitting. So this side peaks. And we believe that they may occur due to the funnel resonance effect. And we model this resonance effect by adding, by changing the formulas for the transmission probability through the dots. And sometimes in order to better represent the behavior of the non-local current, the fitting curves have stronger additional peaks. So here in red, the red curve corresponds to the fitting peak. And the peak is stronger because we need to reproduce this kind of behavior of the thermoelectricity. Finally, we can see that indeed the thermoelectricity have this mod-like behavior because the zero thermoelectric current corresponds to the peak of the maximum of the conductance of the left dot and is symmetrical with respect to the conductance peak of the right dot. So this is the main result of our experimental work. On the left, we have the experimental plots. On the right, the results of the theoretical modeling. This is the non-local current on the left. This is non-local current on the right. And these are Cooper pair splitting and lasting contributions. And we see that both the magnitude and the behavior of the theoretically obtained plots compare well with the experimental ones. And this means that, this probably means that we have indeed observed the non-local thermoelectricity in the graphene Cooper pair. Finally, I should say a few words about local thermoelectricity. So in the experiment, as I said, the total thermoelectric current almost equals to the local one. And if we have this experimental plots for the total thermoelectric current, and we use the same model as we used for modeling the non-local current to model the local currents. The problem with this model is that sometimes it doesn't represent the right behavior. So especially in a low temperature regime, and in order to capture this kind of features, I forgot to say that the blue line corresponds to the smaller temperature, the red line corresponds to the larger temperature difference, and on the bottom we have the conductance peaks. So in order to better represent this low temperature regime, we introduce another model in which we suppose that there is a voltage drop across the graphene quantum dots due to the inelastic relaxation of the particles. And we obtain formulas for the for modeling the local thermoelectricity using the standard scattering matrix approach. So the dot is represented by Fabry-Pérot interferometer, which is connected via beam splitter to a stub. This is done in order to represent the final scattering effect. So using this simple model, we obtain in this incoherent transport assumption, we obtain a pretty good fitting for the curves in a small temperature regime. So this brings me to the end of my presentation. So we have demonstrated experimentally the existence of the non-local Seebeck effect in the graphene-based Cooper pair splitting device. And we have validated our observation with the theoretical plots. And we can see that the results of our theoretical modeling compares well with the experimentally obtained plots. Thank you very much for your attention. I'm ready to answer your questions. Yep. Vladislav, you have raised your hand. Please ask me your question.
Sorry, can you hear me? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, yes. Good. Thank you for the nice talk, Nikita. I have a short question. I'm curious. So I've heard that it could be possible to do something like what you described here, but without the quantum dots, am I getting something wrong? Or like I've heard something about it. Maybe you can comment on it. Well, if you do get what I mean.
It's possible to make a Cooper pair splitter without using quantum dots in the case. Well, we have another work on that topic where we show that if you have a one-dimensional NSN structure, you can actually do the Cooper pair splitting without using the dots if the incident particles are parallel, almost parallel to the NS borders. So you can just make the electrons move in a slicing manner. And
how feasible is this? I'm sorry.
I mean, like the size of the superconductor should be very small. It should be like a couple of nanometers. So it may be not very practical, but we have shown that it is actually possible.
Okay, but it's not practical. Okay.
All right. Not at this moment, I guess.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions? Yes, please. I see the raised hand, Professor Hakkinen.
Nikita, could you tell a bit about this problem that now it looks that at the lowest temperatures you're using incoherent modeling? So what does this mean?
Well, this means that like the thermoelectric voltage and actually drop across the dot. And in this case, instead of the coherent model where like the incident particles are in fully coherent mode inside this dot S dot structure, we have a situation where we can effectively assume that there is a electron reservoir inside the dot, and on this electron reservoir we have a voltage induced by the thermoelectric induced by the temperature difference between the dot and the left normal region. So in this case we have a different situation, and this actually yields us different plots for the local thermoelectricity in a low temperature region. But it appears that this incoherent modeling, like incoherent contribution, plays the significant role only in this low temperature regime and does not have any significant effect when it comes to the higher temperatures.
So could it be that it's more like an effective model for some other phenomena?
Sorry?
Can it be that this inelastic model is more like an effective model for, let's say, Coulomb blockade effects in the system?
I don't really know how it is connected to the Coulomb blockade, because I didn't really consider this type of connection. I don't know how it is connected to the Coulomb blockade, and I don't really have any ideas about this type of things, but maybe, I don't know.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, so if there is no further questions, I have to introduce our next speaker, Dr. Konstantin Lyakhov from Stokholm Mathematical Institute. Dr. Lyakhov, are you here?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes.
Actually, I thought that it will be a different speaker, but according to schedule, it should be another one.
Well, there was supposed to be another talk before me, but unfortunately the speaker couldn't be here today. So it's your turn now.
Okay. Wait a second. So can you see my screen?
Yes.
The title of my talk, maybe I should also look myself, show myself. So the type of metal CO2 laser system design for efficient boron isotope separation by the method of selective laser assisted retardation condensation. On the left, you can see outline contents of my talk, outline, introduction, etc. So outline of my talk, search for cheap production of boron isotopes is very important for in different industries. For example, in nuclear industry and medicine and the need is the most big for this isotope. The goal is of this research is to design a laser system which can provide desired spectral characteristics of a laser pulse to separate boron isotopes efficiently within a steelwork method. So this abbreviation means this laser assisted retardative condensation method. So this method was originally proposed by Lin, his patent in 1977, and modeled by Irkins in 2005. The next is to find the values of basic parameters for this system, such as an acceptable variation range of the laser operating pressure, more locking laser system design, and estimation of acceptable interval for the variation laser intensity for various positions of photo absorption lines of boron sulfide, corresponding to ambiguity for available experimental data. In new formalism, which takes into account spectral shape of photo absorption cross section and laser pulse emission spectrum, is developed. The next is conclusion that the three lines is four times more efficient than single line and eight times than two lines excitation has been derived. So more details of my talk can be found in recent publication in Applied Physics. First of all, I briefly explain this method and its advantages. Target isotopes can be selectively excited by the photons of appropriate frequency. In contrast to another popular method, as molecular obliteration and atomic vapor and separation of isotopes and atomic vapor, laser fluence should be just high enough for molecular excitation, and therefore able to guide molecular dynamics in the desired direction. So I will tell it later. So this method is potentially more energy efficient because of just needed photon energy to excite target isotope. Firstly, because of high excitation rate due to typically two orders of magnitude larger cross section, so this corresponds to photo absorption cross section corresponding to multi-photon absorption at larger laser intensities. In this method, Sievert method, isotope harvesting is based on the fact that lighter species diffuse to the gas flow periphery faster than heavy species. Hence, heavy and light species are fully separated by the end of the gas flow, corresponding to the skinner inlet position, and pumped out towards related pole traps. If gas flow temperature is too high, then hot rotational bands are strongly populated. Hence, in order to decrease this effect, irradiated gas flow should be sufficiently dilute and cold. This can be achieved by its supersonic cooling. Selective action of the laser beam relies upon resonant energy absorption of laser photons by target isotope analogs, preventing their condensation, which would occur otherwise in supersonic gas flow. In dilute, overcooled gas flow collision broadening is dominant and small, so that the photo absorption spectra are very narrow. In similar method, the choice of target gas molecules and carrier gas play an essential role. We consider boron-3 chloride as the target gas molecule due to excitability of its spectrum by CO2 laser and high enough vapor pressure at room temperature. At room temperature, fundamental vibrational modes, denoted by nu 3 of isotopologues, LL means boron 11 isotope 35. Corresponds to chlorine 35 and 37, chlorine 37. So N corresponds to numbers from 1 to 3. So this isotopologue can be readily excited by the following CO2 laser lines. So the range from 10 p4 to 10 p28. For laser intensity is lower than saturation limit. 10 p8, 10 p16 lines are better absorbed, while at larger laser intensities, when multiphoton processes get more important, photo absorption maximums are redshifted. So that using 10 p24, 10 p28 lines are more appropriate. By increasing operating pressure of the laser medium, frequency mismatches can be compensated by emission lines broadening. In order to enhance boron isotopes recovery, multi-line excitation of boron chloride, having four photo absorption peaks related to different combination of boron 11 with chlorine isotopes can be used. In this slide is shown the principal scheme of boron isotope separation. Mixture of target gas and carrier gas is stored in a mixing tank and expands continuously through specifically designed slit nozzle. It is irradiated crosswise by a laser beam. Laser beam impinges gas flow from the from this side, so it can be fully irradiated. Gas flow can be fully irradiated. We assume that irradiation cell is performed the multi-pass cavity to generate short multi-line pulses mode locking, but one grating, here's grating configuration can be implemented. In this case, laser beam is confined between one flat, this one flat mirror, and two concave mirrors, M1 and M2. They have curvature radius 25 centimeters. Green cylinder is mode locker. By this arrow, gas flow is denoted by this arrow. By the end of gas flow, skimmer blades are installed. So this skimmer blades. So they separate the gas flow to two fractions. One fraction is target isotope depleted, obviously the central core of gas flow, and the peripheral part is target isotope saturated. As a carrier gas, we assume argon because of its best aerodynamical properties. So the central part is accumulated in cold trap. So because of low enrichment factor, so it can be directed back to mixing tank and so reiterated until desired
Unfortunately, you have stopped sharing the screen.
I don't know what happened, but maybe it's related with my program. Just a second. Sometimes it's suspended unexpectedly. Sorry. So can you see my screen?
Yes.
I briefly discussed this figure. Now I jump to this my calculations for boron 3 chloride photo absorption cross section. The values of photo absorption cross section can be for each line correspond to different chlorine isotope levels of boron 3 chloride are related with infrared intensities. Why this formula? According to experimental data, infrared intensity takes this value. So as soon as we know this value, we can take into account that collision and Doppler broadening are comparable at considered gas flow pressure and temperature. So that can be estimated by void profile. We can substitute calculated before values for Doppler and collision broadening line widths. So in this formula, this maximum which I calculate from infrared intensity, we can get values for of photo absorption we can get a spectrum photo absorption cross section. Formula is denoted that Borsley chloride as a topologue has n runs from 1 to 3, so it has a three combinations of formula, and they belong to one of two symmetric groups D3H TV, depending on whether the mass of chlorine isotopes are equal or not. We can evaluate probabilities for finding of the combination of different chlorine isotopes in boron 3 chloride. Finally, we get four probabilities and four corresponding to four lines. So first line corresponds to this combinations of chlorine isotopes. The force this one to this combination, and this is just for this and this one and this one. So and finally you get values for maximum of photo absorption cross section for each line. So this my result. So for maximum of photo absorption cross section. Here given this discussion for experimental constraints. Precise experimental identification photo absorption line center position of the gas that stays boron lens chloride is ambiguous so far. It ranges from this value according to this measurements and to this value according to this more earlier measurements. We'll use in our simulations both streams to estimate the appropriate laser intensity range to the designed CO2 laser system. The distances between neighbor peaks corresponding to different combination of chlorine isotopes are taken from the experimental data for boron chloride frozen in argon matrix. So this estimation is just experimental data. So in this table, this table summarizes data for CO2 laser emission line and boron chloride absorption line absorption lines wave numbers. So first line each line corresponds to nearest nearest CO2 laser line to boron chloride absorption line. So we see that this line 10P4 corresponds to this combination of chlorine isotopes in boron chloride, and so on. So we see this for another combination, and for this combination of chlorine atom. So wave numbers of CO2 laser emission and boron chloride absorption line maximum correspond to the choice of the lambda one max, so is, which corresponds to one of extremes of in experimental data. So it ranges from one extreme to another extreme because so there is some ambiguity, as I said. So this table summarizes for one of ambiguities of experimental data. Another table corresponds to another ambiguity of to another extreme for position of photo absorption cross section of boron chloride. So we see that in this case already 10P8 or 8 line can be used. So this is more feasible because it is very difficult to produce 10P4 line in CO2 laser. So normally it starts from 10P8 and still it's very small. So in order to develop photo absorption in emission spectrum with photo absorption spectrum of boron chloride, so it should be chosen minimum values of full width at half of maximum of 10P4 and to 10 larger lines. This TVHM should take these values. So it's quite big as we seen. So lines 28 and 22 the nearest to the related photoabsorption lines. But only a single line excitation is feasible. As I said, because 28 is is only perceptible as in the interval of wavelengths. Depending on the pressure in the laser media, it could be used as one laser line THM, should be at least one reciprocal centimeters, or two laser lines, so which corresponds to this combination of chlorine isotopes. In this case, THM should be 1.31 reciprocal centimeters. THM for rotor vibrational transition lines of CO2 laser can be estimated by this formula. It's quite a common one formula, which it takes into account different molar fraction in a laser medium, and m is on angular momentum. So we assume that if a temperature of laser medium greater than 470 kelvins, then this details I will skip it. So we see that in this case laser medium pressure is very high, and then plasma discharge can be unstable. So we assume that in our estimation that a cooling system can stabilize laser medium temperature at 350 Kelvin. By increasing temperature, we can achieve overlap with nearest photoabsorption lines. So operating pressure, which corresponds to two photoabsorption line excitations, should be higher than 70 bars. Here in this point, it is considered in another extreme that for in experimental data. In this case, in order to overlap, we should have this values of THM. NP8, NP12 lines should be used for simultaneous excitation of chlorine isotope LOX. In this case, a laser medium pressure should be 5.7 bars. So it which gives THM 0.81 reciprocal centimeters. Mode locking can be used for multi-line laser pulse generation. So this tau p is laser pulse length, so it is related with modulation amplitude, frequency, or resonator length, and saturated around excess gas, excess gain, excess gas per unit length. So assuming this number, in our simulation, we assume this numbers to estimate laser pulse length. This choice for pressure gives laser pulse width 9.7 picoseconds for excitation of this combination of chlorine chlorine atoms, or 2 picoseconds for excitation this combination of chlorine atoms, or both of them. This line corresponds to one line excitation, and 14.11 picoseconds corresponds to the choice, this choice of or three line excitation. In this slide, it is shown boron three chloride multi line excitation. it's time evolution of the laser intensity inside the cavity. So this the electric field or at some fixed time is a superposition of the electric field from the previously emitted laser pulses over the total time interval elapsed t. So we get this formula in order to take into account multi-line laser pulse electric field strength is one or three or four larger emission lines and L, so K runs from one and LL and this yields this formula. The number of laser pulses can be calculated as the upper bound of this ratio, the, where TP is inverse of frequency of modulation frequency, the interaction time of the larger pulse. So we assume this this value 1.1 mm. So this then we get interaction time. We get this formula for for term of an electric field in this summation. So and we assume the Gaussian envelope for larger line intensities. So here we see this approximation. So we as a Fourier transform of this kernels. FK this FK is take this form and TK GK depends on time inverse population build up times tau R which correspond to different transition lines. And for pay from pulse to pulse according to some random process. So it should be also point out that this actually stability of laser power can be poor in this case. So as the next step, you take the average of equation 14, so this one. Over the length of intersection between the laser beam and the gas flow. So we get, so this, this angle brackets and X corresponds to this average, taking average. So it can be represented as a product of amplitudes, E0 correspond to different different lines, and this sums each term of this sum f j k, so it also can be represented as a Fourier transform of complex conjugate of amplification factor q less. So it will be shown later. And FK, as I showed, shown here. And here it is explained how average is carried out. And in order to sum up these terms, we take into account this formula. So this equation can be represented as a inverse Fourier transform of this quantity. This quantity looks like that. This And so by TK, it is the average of relaxation times. We get this formula for laser intensity for each line K, laser pulse intensity. So they're related with the respective transition line gain loss ratio. Gain loss ratio can be adjusted to almost the same level by introduction of specific losses. Now, when equal build up times yield almost instantaneous oscillation keep off for each line, and laser intensity for each line can be adjusted to the same reference laser intensity, in this case, we get this expression. In this point is explained the distribution of laser electric field amplification factor. As far as you consider multipass cavity, amplification factor, I took into account this amplification factor. It can be related with this zinc selenide window electric field transmission and reflectivity coefficients at a given wavelength. So I got this expression for this amplification factor. Alpha I 1 is given is related with frequency omega WIC, it is width of a radiation cell, and X is coordinate between mirrors. Sigma A omega is photo absorption cross section, and I is target is a topologue's density, and the delta is distance between gas flow edge and nearest mirror. In this figure, shown spectrum of amplification factor square. It is seen deep at excitation frequency due to absorption by target gas. Here is discussed constraints on the laser intensity. So excitation rate corresponding to pulse multimode radiation can be estimated as this sum, where excitation line of given as a topology is given by this formula. So again, we have a summation of a number of lines. RL is laser beam radius, and inverse Fourier transform of this expression. So it is given by this formula. So it is we call it as a spectral number density of absorbed photons, and the spectral energy density related can be represented by this formula. So I defined all this quantities before, so I just substituting into here and get finally following results for laser pulse intensity for one pulse. So the time is so short that just only one pulse is emitted. In this figure is shown time evolution of laser field inside the resonant cavity over the time interval corresponding NP laser shot. So in this Higgins quite clearly shown that different points correspond to either second, 100, 200 until 600 laser pulses. So energy per laser pulse is 20 nanojoules. One line excitation by laser pulse is one line laser spectrum is assumed. So it has this, it's 32 gigahertz and corresponds to choice of photo absorption cross photo absorption cross section photo absorption of Bohr's infrared corresponds to this extreme. So I explained it before. So in this slide, it is shown laser pulse intensity evolution for first pulse, and here again shown a time evolution laser field for different pulses, but already for two lines excitation with one line laser spectrum. And this choice of photo absorption cross section of Bohr's infrared is chosen. And finally, this final set of figures corresponds to four line excitation by laser pass with three lines laser spectrum. So in this case, laser line width is 22 gigahertz. And in another extreme for photo absorption cross section is chosen. So in order to calculate average number of photons, so resonant absorbed by each is the power of the molecule can be evaluated by carrying out integration over T of excitation rates. So in order to prevent multi-photon dissociation, the number of photons absorbed within excitation loss characteristic time interval should be less as this critical number of photons, so which can be evaluated as a dissociation threshold over critical energy density. According to equation 35, the upper limit for the larger density for given photo absorption line is given by this formula. So here is equation 25. Here critical according to experimental data is critical means critical larger fluence. So it is 20 joule over centimeter square. And the multi-photon photo absorption cross section is evaluated as a dissociation threshold over critical fluence. So we get value for multiphoton absorption cross section. The low limit for applicability of Steel-Arc method can be evaluated by this formula. So I refer to this. We assume that just 1 kilowatts and AK is evaluated in the case of choosing boron cichloride absorption spectrum corresponding to this experimental extreme. And the one line excitation. So the average number of photons absorbed by each absorption line from a 10p8 emission line, they have these values. So lower and upper limits for the laser intensity in this case, according to these formulas in max for each line, in this case, three lines. So, so you mean 156 watt in max 663 megawatts. We repeat this procedure for case of two lines excitation. In order to get the value for average numbers of photons solved by each absorption line from 10 P8 emission line. So in this case, our results are following. So you can see. So the lower and upper limits for the laser intensity in this case should be is this value or no 450 watt or maximum well 2 gigawatts. In the case of choosing boron silicate absorption spectrum corresponding to the three line excitation, and this choice of photo absorption photo absorption spectrum, calculated number of absorbed photons are following. So you see that they are the biggest one. So absorption is the most significant in this case. So, but of course, we also should keep in mind that ambiguity of experimental data, so which is expressed by this assumption. Thus, the lower and upper limits for the laser intensity should be summarized in this table. So, for absorption of 10 P8, only 10 P8 line laser intensity should have this interval, and for this line, this interval, and for 10 P12 line, this interval. So, therefore, laser photons use efficiency for one or two and or and three photo absorption line excitation are following. So we see that photon use efficiency is the highest for three lines excitation, so 73.8%. So here I jump to summary. So new CO2 laser system for multi-line boron isotope separation has been proposed. Its important characteristics, such as acceptable variation range of the laser intensity, laser pulse spectrum, computed. This computation will carry out by taking into account multiple laser beam reflection in the resonant cavity and the variation of photo absorption spectrum, central lines position due to the ambiguity of available experimental data of boron silicate chloride in gaseous state. Has been compared the efficiency of laser energy absorption for excitation by one, two, or three lines laser pulse. So that's it. Thank you for your attention. And here, acknowledgements. So this work was supported by this grant. And please ask your questions.
Any questions? Okay, so I can ask you a question. Why do you use so short laser pulses? I mean, it's like 1.1 millimeters, right? Could you do the same thing with a like regular CW laser?
What do you mean so short? The pulse length is from 10 to 100 picoseconds, so it is not too short. You mean pulse length in time domain, right?
Yes, I mean on one of the slides there was the size of the pulse 1.5 millimeters. Why do you need to use pulses? Can you do the same thing with just a coherent, like a simple CW laser?
CO, Actually, the problem is that we need to, so there is a mismatch between photoabsorption spectrum and emission lines. So it is not possible to, to tune by available means to photoabsorption spectrum of boron sulfide, but it's very sensitive because if photoabsorption line is too far from emission line, so enrichment factor and efficiency drops dramatically. So it's because of photoabsorption lines are extremely narrow because it is. Or we could get slow, so we should tune to laser lines as much as possible to closely to photoabsorption lines. So if it is not, so we lose, we lose isotopes. We cannot actually excite them.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions? Well, in the case that we don't have any other questions, then I would like to, Professor Isevik.
Hello, I just listened to you. Yet. I have no questions.
Okay. In the case that no one has any questions, then I would like to thank everyone for participating in today's session. And we're looking forward to see you tomorrow and the day after. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
So, till tomorrow.
Bye-bye.